John Wesley was the organizer, the visionary. He was the one that got things started, but his brother Charles sure expressed their theology in a deep and profound way. I encourage you all to look at that hymn. That's some powerful stuff in there, and some theology that actually got Mr. Wesley in trouble, claiming to be made perfect by God's love, so that everything that we say and do is motivated by love and love alone, that there's nothing that gets in the way in between God's love and our actions and our words. That's a remarkable claim, and one that Wesley made and is expressed in that hymn. One of his favorite passages, one of his favorite books of the Bible, in fact, was the book of Hebrews. And Hebrews chapter 10 was one he preached on frequently, including in this passage, 19 through 25 from chapter 10. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The great and wise American poet Maya Angelou said, "A friend may be waiting behind a stranger's face." What a great thought that is, a beautiful thought, and as I see it, a very Christian thought, a very Christ-like thought. In Hebrews 13:12, we read, "Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for in so doing some have welcomed angels without knowing it." A reference to several Old Testament stories in which hospitality was shown to strangers, and those strangers turned out to be messengers from God. Jesus himself said in a very deep and profound way, "I was a stranger and you welcomed me." When was it, Jesus? When did we see you as a stranger? We've known you forever. How are you a stranger? And he said, "Every time you welcomed any stranger, even the least of these, you welcomed me. I was a stranger and you welcomed me." They pushed him on it. They questioned him on it. "Who is my neighbor?" said a lawyer one day. That was a question in response to Jesus' answer. The lawyer had asked, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What do I have to do to get to heaven? And Jesus said, "You already know the answer to that question. Love God with everything that you are and love your neighbor as yourself." But lawyers are rarely satisfied with the first answer, and so he dug deeper. "But who is my neighbor?" And Jesus told him the story, right? The story of the Good Samaritan, in which the neighbor in question turned out to be not only a stranger, but also an enemy. Someone between whom there would have been some animosity, right? Who is my neighbor? Who is a stranger? Jesus blurs the lines all the time. He challenges us in another place in Matthew. What good is it for you to love people who already love you? What good does that do? Everyone does that. That's just what it means to be a person. Everyone loves people who already love them. There's nothing particularly Christian about that. But rather, what I want my followers to do, said Jesus, is to love your enemies, love the strangers, love the ones who are actively persecuting you. Wow, what a challenge. That word for stranger that appears so often in the New Testament is actually the Greek word ethnos. Jesus says, "I was an ethnos." And ethnos is a Greek word that we still have in our vocabulary. From time to time, you will hear it used in a couple of pretty negative connotations with the two words that are slipping out of my brain right now. It's not ethnos, it's xenos. That's why it slipped out of my brain. Thank you so very much. I gave you the wrong Greek word. Xenos is the word for stranger. And therefore, it's easy to see the connection to two very negative words, xenophobia and xenocide. Two words that we have in our vocabulary that mean those who are other are to be feared, and those who are other are to be killed. What a dramatic way to talk about the other, whereas Jesus says, I was one of those. I was a xenos, and you welcomed me. Stranger danger, we tell our kids. Stranger danger, stay away, be safe. And that's good, we should do that. But when we do that, we have to realize what Scripture says about those strangers. That behind the face of every stranger, there's a friend. There's someone who needs to know that God loves them. There's someone who needs to know grace, who needs to know compassion. The only thing I would change about Maya Angelou's quote is I would take out the word maybe and put is always. A friend is always waiting behind a stranger's face. Making those personal connections one-on-one with others is a vital part of what it means to follow Jesus. It's a vital part of the ministry of this congregation, and it's a vital component of the vision for ministry that we're rolling out now, expanding connections. The first connection is the one God makes with you. And last week, Emily talked about that initial connection. You're at the center of these connections because God is acting first in your life. God is reaching out to you, whether you know it or not, whether you're comfortable with that or not. God's grace is seeking you out. That is the nature of God's grace. You have been created by God. God has breathed into you the breath of life. You have been forgiven of your sin. Uniquely, distinctly you are forgiven by the grace of Jesus Christ. You have been gifted the gifts of the Spirit. You have unique gifts that make you who you are. In that way, the triune God makes the initial connection with each one of us. And that's what it means to practice an evangelical faith. A faith where you understand that one's personal relationship with God is at the core of everything. Evangelical has come to mean a voting block. It flat out does not mean a voting block. In fact, evangelicals vote in a number of different ways. It has nothing to do with how you vote. It has to do with what you think about one's personal relationship with God and how important that is. So our vision starts at the very center with the affirmation, with the evangelical affirmation that your personal relationship with God is very, very significant and very, very important and the start of it all. But it doesn't stop there. It doesn't stop with God's grace in your life. It only starts there, and then from there it moves outward. And the first ring of connection that we make in our vision are those one-on-one personal relationships with our friends. You got a friend in me, with the people that we see, and we say, I'm sorry you were feeling sick last week. I'm glad you're better today. With the people we see and say, hey, great job on that promotion, way to go, I'm proud of you. Those people that we know and connect with one-on-one, individually, in those friendships around us. Now, I always knew that there was sort of an upper limit on the number of friends anyone could have, but I never knew that it had a name. There is an upper limit on the number of friends you can have, and it is called Dunbar's number. Dunbar's number is 150. So somewhere right in that range, we max out at the number of friendships we can maintain. Now, of course, we know more people than that. We know about more people than that. And of course, we have more intimate friends and family that are a smaller number than that. But as far as just people we know and we know how they connect to one another, 150, and that's based on brain size. That's based on the size of one's neocortex. And so we need to fill up our Dunbar numbers, followers of Jesus. We need to make those connections. We need to understand that maybe Dunbar was wrong and we could get 200 friends, right? We always need to be seeking those connections, those one-on-one connections. Personal friendships are at the heart of everything that we do in our relationships. There's no program that we can implement as a congregation to make those friendships happen. There is no curriculum by which we can teach how to make friends. in spite of some books that are titled that way, it doesn't really work. You actually have to just do it, right? This is individual initiative. This is individuals meeting other individuals. And it's vitally important to constantly be seeking those connections. You know this. As a follower of Jesus, you know this. As a human being that lives in the world, you know this. It's important in the life of a congregation too. The reason this is a part of our congregational vision for ministry is because it is vitally important to the health of a congregation. The number one reason that people come to church the first time is a personal invitation. Website is fine, flyers is fine, television commercial, whatever. The number one reason anyone comes is because you invite them. A personal invitation to a worship service, to a Sunday school class, to a mission project, whatever it is. That's the number one reason that people come the first time. The number one reason that people come back again, two or four or six more times, is because the program is good. They like the content of the service, they like the music, they like the preaching was fam, they like the Sunday school is good stuff, you know, they like the program. So excellence in programming is the number one reason that people will come back to a church. But do you know the number one reason that a person decides to stay at a church and make that church their home? It's friendships. It's people. It's connecting with people in significant ways. It's knowing that you're going to see someone there, and when they see you, they're going to smile and shake your hand or give you a hug. It's friendships. And for that reason, it is vitally important that everyone who's a part of a congregation is continually seeking ways to make those friendships, to fill up our Dunbar numbers and go beyond and connect with others. Now, like I said, there's no program that we can instill. There's no book we can use to teach, but there are things we can do to help that along. One of them is to wear your name tags when you're at church. And I understand that after the first and second services, some people were tipped off that was going to be a part of the sermon, so you went on out and made sure to get them. They're very easy to get to. They're right out there on the wall, so grab them when you come by. If you don't have one, call the church office, tell them to make you one, and they will. But that's just a really easy way to say, hey, here's me. This is who I am. This is who I am. And I'd like to offer a bit of myself to you so that we can connect on another level. But there's another way to do it, which we're going to do right now. Like I said, no fancy program or anything, but it's a game, right? So you've played this game before, probably when you were a kid. And as a kid at a birthday party, you may have called it musical chairs. What we're calling it in our worship service this morning is musical pews. So everybody stand up, and as Bill plays the music, you will be walking around the room. And when the music stops, you will sit down in the closest pew to wherever you happen to be at that moment. Anyone understand? You can bring your stuff if you want to. It's fine. But here we go. Musical pews with the music, and let's go. Move it around now. Keep it going. No right way to do this. Just keep on going. Way to go. That's right. Don't go to a different side altogether. Move it around. Shake it up. One more time around. I know, I saw. They're just walking around. All right. Sit down. Wherever you are. Nice job. I know. Now, you may know the people next to you, you may not. Take this opportunity now to say hi, to turn around. You know who you are, know who you're sitting by, right? Now, how fun that was, right? It's just weird. It's all, nice job. I got to tell you, though, even from up here, it's really strange. It's unsettling. Because, I don't even know if Molly is not, are you even here? I didn't know, because that's where I usually go, so. Now, James, I didn't say move back yet. You got to, so good. So the idea, it may be silly, and you may have grumbled at me for that, but the idea, right, is that this is what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to connect with others in new ways, make these new connections, form these new friendships. As followers of Jesus, this is the most, after the connection God makes with you, this is the most fundamental connection that a follower of Jesus can make. Those connections with those strangers, right? But behind the face of every stranger is a friend that you just simply haven't had a chance to meet yet. Right? And for the sake of God's love, for the sake of God's grace, we take those risks and meet those friends. So just hang out where you are for just a second. Get a little comfortable in your song. The next ring in our vision also is about personal connections, but there's a little more intentionality behind this ring of connection. In Hebrews 10, in the passage that I read just a little bit ago, we read a beautiful phrase. Let's provoke one another to love and good deeds. I love that phrase, provoke one another. When you provoke someone, I don't usually think of it in positive terms, right? You provoke someone, it's usually you end up annoying them. Like I just provoked all of you and really annoyed you for making you sit in a different spot, right? But we're provoking one another to love and good deeds. We are talking about here encouraging one another, keeping each other on track, making sure that we're following Christ as closely as we are able. And that requires a little more intentionality than just those face-to-face friendships that are all around us. It is a chance to do what Paul says to do, encourage one another and build one another up, as indeed you are doing, 1 Thessalonians. In another place, Paul says it this way, let no evil talk come out of your mouth, but only what is useful for building up as there is need, so that your words may give grace to those who hear. How is it that your words are giving grace to someone to build them up, to help them and support them and encourage them in their own Christian discipleship? That kind of trust, that kind of understanding between and among people doesn't happen in a large group setting. It happens best in a small group. And as we talk about getting together in these smaller groups, we're not reinventing the wheel here. This is all about what John Wesley did to initiate the Methodist Church itself. He got together in smaller groups of people, and there were four things his groups did: advise, reprove, comfort, and exhort. Advise, reprove, comfort, and exhort. Sometimes there's need for comfort. Sometimes there's need for advice. Sometimes there's need to exhort, to get them going, to get them charged up. It is a chance to check in with one another, to ask some deep kind of soul questions. How is your soul today? More than just congratulations on the promotion. How is your soul? Where have you seen God this past week? Where have you not seen God? Where have you felt God's absence in your life this past week? What did you enjoy about the worship service? Well, not that moving around part. I don't like that, man. What did you get out of the songs? What was your favorite hymn from the week? And what did you learn there? In your Bible study this week, what insight did you gain and how could you share that? So these kind of deeper questions about discipleship, they require more than just passing in the hall and saying howdy. They require intentionality and regular, ongoing conversations so that that trust can be developed, so that that level of relationship can truly deepen. There's an intentionality about that encouragement and accountability that happens at this level. And some people have that group, which is great. Some people have that group of people that keep you on track, that keep your life focused, that you can be real with, right? That you can be completely honest with about your discipleship, about your life, about your faith, about everything. But not everyone has that level of trust in a smaller group. Not everyone has that opportunity. If you do, awesome, keep it up. But I would also challenge you to ask yourself truly and honestly, is it really that? Is the group that you're thinking of really that level? So for example, could you go to that group and say, you know what, I had an opportunity right in front of me this week to help somebody who needed help, but I didn't take that opportunity because I was afraid of what might happen. I mean, could you go that deep with that person, with those people, and feel grace and feel understanding and feel encouragement to try differently next time around? That's the kind of level we're talking about. So for those who want that kind of support and accountability, we're kind of actually creating a whole new set of groups called life groups. That's that next ring of connection in our vision. Those life groups are intended to be that small group who will keep you focused, keep you going, cheer for you along the way, encourage you when you fail, and help you stay accountable to the discipleship that you're called to live. In fact, leaders for those life groups are being trained. This afternoon, we're going to start our first wave of those life groups here in the next couple of weeks. And then in the fall, another wave after we pilot the program this spring. That's a chance for people to connect together at a much deeper level. The goal is that everyone who follows Jesus would have that level of trust, that level of accountability, that level of support in our Christian discipleship. Because I'm telling you, I know that there are some people who think they can follow Jesus on their own. I get that. There are a ton of people who say, I don't need the church to follow Jesus. I just follow Jesus on my own. That's fine. Whatever. I don't begrudge those people that at all. Do it. Go for it. I can't do that. I need you to keep me on track. And I believe that we need each other. We need each other to stay focused, to stay accountable, and to deepen our commitment. Right? To deepen our commitment to following Jesus as closely as we possibly can. If you took your stuff with you, get the bulletin insert from the bulletin. And if you didn't take your stuff with you, find the bulletin insert of the person who was sitting in that spot where you were. And if you don't have one, share with the person sitting next to you that you just met and made good friends with. Because on the back side of that bulletin insert is our congregation's mission statement and our congregation's identity statement. Now, those things are nothing more than the answer to two simple questions. The first is, what is our purpose for existing? And the second is, who are we? And I'd like for us to share these out loud together. So let me ask you, Campbell, what is our purpose for existing? Campbell's mission is to help people become disciples of Jesus Christ who are changing the world for God's sake. And Campbell United Methodist Church, who are we? Campbell is a United Methodist congregation whose core values are grace, creativity, authenticity, inclusivity, and selfless service. So yes, church starts with you. You're at the center of the vision. God's first act is to connect with you. By grace, God does that. You connect with your Creator, but it doesn't stop there. That fundamental connection both empowers and instructs us to connect with others, to expand those connections for Christ's sake. We don't do this alone. We don't live this life alone. We don't follow Jesus alone. And as far as I'm concerned, that is profoundly good news. For a follower of Jesus, a friend is always waiting, even behind a stranger's face. And there's a fundamental reason, a basic reason, why this is a part of our vision for ministry, why this is such a point of emphasis. Just because, quite frankly, it is good to know. It's good to know. Ain't it? Ain't it good to know that you've got a friend? Would you pray with me, please? God, you assure us by your grace that we do have a friend. It is good to know, oh God, that we're connected to one another by your grace. Help us to seek those connections, those healthy connections that energize us and encourage us, provide us with courage. Keep us on track. Keep us focused on you. God, we offer our decisions to you. We offer our lives to you. We offer our discipleship to you. In Jesus' holy name, and by the power of your ever-present Spirit. Amen.